here this morning, I don't see any visitors on me, I do forget, doesn't matter. Also, before I forget, turn, be sure to turn your pink papers on, make it out, you've been forgetting. But also, as we come to, once again, there's something to bring out, what's the end of Jesus' calling? Learn to live from your true center in, try this again. Learn to live from your true center in me. I desire the deepest depth of your being, and turn you into your spirit. It is at this deep level that my peace reigns continually. You will not find lasting peace in the world around you, in circumstances or in human relationships. The external world is always in flux. Under the curse of death and decay, but there is a goal in the minds of peace deep within you, waiting to be tapped. Take time to divide into the riches of my residing presence. I want you to live increasingly from your real center, where my love has eternal grip on you. I am Christ in you, the hope of glory. Colossians 3:15, Colossians 1:27. Sometimes I think we need reminders who's in control. We're not always sure sometimes of things going around us. As we go to the prayer request and we know the things that are happening. But as we go in, any other besides what's in? Yes, John.
I have a few.
Okay.
Keep Bobby in your prayers. She was feeling better, then we went out to do some errands on Friday, and she's relapsed and not feeling well again. Also, Pinky is feeling sick this morning, and I'd like to prayer for her because she has some stressful things coming up. I have a prayer of praise. Shannon Retz, the young lady that cleans our church for us weekly, had a baby girl on Friday morning. The girl's name was Aubrey Lynn. I'd like prayers for her and for the baby for health. That's it.
Okay. Anybody else? Yes, Jeff.
Word from Athelstan Palmer that his mother has been in a hospital with breathing problems, Francis, and is getting better. There's a possibility that she might be home by now, but they weren't too sure whether she had to go to rehab first.
Yeah, that's the answer we're talking about. She gets a little better, so the answer stays contact with her. Is anybody on your hand? Yes.
We have praise. My mother-in-law had her scan on Wednesday, and she is still recovering.
Good.
And she has very little lung left, which they do, but they're maybe looking into something that can help repair some of that damage.
You see that lung left, you mean she does, she lost one of the lungs?
Well, the radiation damaged.
Oh, okay.
Damage the diaphragm muscle, so one is actually recessed up. She really only has like one lung.
Oh, wow.
That lung is not very good.
That's amazing they can be able to build on that. Can you hand the back?
Yep. Ted, I just want prayer for my niece. She's in the hospital. She may be coming home today, but they're not sure. She's 27 years old and suffering from a severe bout of ulcerative colitis. She was diagnosed about a year ago. She's very sick.
I saw this morning an email. Ken Cavey's, Pastor Ken Cavey, his mom has been put into hospice to keep the baby better.
Yes.
Found out that my friend Robin Bowman came through her surgery okay. They were doing great through it. They realized they didn't have to do bypass. They just had to put some stents in, and she's home.
Okay, so for the praise then.
Yes.
Thankful Dawn's back with us.
Yes, yeah.
Thank you.
And we also have somebody else who came back from Florida a couple, some better day back safety too, so. We kind of take turns going to Florida and come back. Okay, let's go for it. Lord, as we come to you, in our petitions and our prayer requests, we praise you. I can't possibly lay on the ground, I can't do you think the ones who are in need of your comfort need of reassurance that you're there with them, help understand some of the things you're going through. At the same time, hear the praises of where you have been, to show that you, no matter what, you're still in control. And I did mention Suzanne, just keep her in Boston with her too. It's just that once in a few hard times this morning, and God's passing. But as you listen and hear our prayers, as you listen and hear our praises, as always to remember, that we praise you for everything and in all things. I think now about as we go back this week, give us the strength and the ability to do our jobs, to do the things that you have to do. Always be remembered to always be willing to give an answer for the hope that I will give to anyone who's answered. And we do that. We pray now for as we hear, give us the ears of listening and minds.
Numbers. We live by numbers. We track and count and measure everything. And sometimes we think the only numbers that really matter are the big ones. But it's the single digits that make the difference. The Bible says that heaven rejoices with the number one. Yeah, heaven rejoices each time even one person comes to know Jesus. We pastors dream about big numbers, and we should. But a daily focus on one meaningful interaction for Christ, that's the true difference maker. One friend, one family member, one co-worker, one person at a time. We want to see God move in our nation like we have never seen before, but it all starts with one. I've got my one, and now I'm challenging you and your church to join us and to find yours. Because ultimately, the only number that really matters is one. Who's your one?
Please turn with me now in your hymnals to hymn 135, and we'll sing the first three verses of Nothing But the Blood.
Thank you. his sons to glory. Behold the man upon the cross, my sin upon his shoulders. Ashamed I hear my mocking voice, calling among the scars. It was my sin that held him there, until it was
snow was rolling in. My mama called me to make sure I was okay. She said, I hear you guys are getting a lot of snow. I said, well, that depends on how you define a lot. I said, it's probably going to bring us up to normal if we get the max. She said, well, we got 100 inches on the ground and we got 5 more inches coming tonight. I said, yeah, we don't have nothing compared to that. So, see, it could be worse. It could be worse. We're going to be talking about finishing well. The seed of this started a few weeks ago when we talked about Hezekiah and how the Hezekiah was given 15 more years. And Brother Wayne made a comment about thinking about if he was guaranteed another 15 years. We're not guaranteed another 5 minutes, but Hezekiah was guaranteed 15 years. And I started thinking about that, looked into it a little bit more, and realized that Hezekiah blew the last 15 years of his life. He had lived a good life up to that point, and God set his time. And he begged and prayed, and we know the story how that God gave him another 15 years, and he ruined not only his life, but his family's life, and the kingdom.
talk about that a little bit more next week. So we're going to do this in a three-part series. Finishing well, we're going to talk to the positive folks, folks that did finish well. Next week, we're going to talk about folks in the Bible that did not finish well. And interestingly enough, a number of those people are in the Faith Hall of Fame. The Hebrew Hall of Fame that we see in the book of Hebrews, but they did not finish well. And then part three will be what you and I, some strategies for what you and I can do to finish well and leave a good legacy. But today, we're going to be talking, and we're going to be taking our reference out of the book of Timothy. And this is the verse. And now the time is fast approaching for my release from this life, and I'm ready to be offered as a sacrifice. I have fought an excellent fight, I have finished my full course, and I've kept my heart full of faith. There's a crown of righteousness waiting in heaven for me, and I know that my Lord will reward me on his day of righteous judgment. And this crown is not only waiting for me, but for all who love and long for his unveiling. Let's pray. Lord, open our hearts this morning. We pray that those that could not be here, that you would raise them up. We pray that those who did not want to be here, you will give them a burden. And we're thankful for everyone who did come out. We just pray that you would give us something for our lives, for our hopes, for our dreams, and for our futures. In your name we ask. Amen. John Maxwell tells the following story. Personnel manager had advertised a job opening, and there were a large group of qualified candidates sitting in the reception area. The first young man interviewed, young lady brought him in. She explained to the job, explained to him the job and the requirements, and she said this to him: "We need someone in this job who can make fast decisions. Someone who can really think on his feet. Can you show me that you're capable of that?" Quietly, he got up, went to the door, opened the door, and said, "Okay, you guys, thanks for coming in, but you can all go home now because the job has been filled." Sometimes, be careful what you ask for, because you can get it. Yes, he can make a quick decision. He wanted the job, and he found a way to cut everybody else out. See, many people are afraid of making the wrong decision. Some want to analyze everything, and that's not a bad thing. Important decisions should be analyzed, good, bad. Talk to different people about it. But there is a possibility of analysis paralysis, that you know so much about it, you're just afraid of making a decision. Because you're afraid of making a wrong decision, so you choose to make no decision. Back in the business world, when I worked with bureaucrats and I would try and get a bureaucrat to make a decision, it was a very difficult thing. As a young man, I'd made a big proposal for a major educational facility in upstate New York. The individual agreed that my proposal would save the institution a large amount of money over many years, increase the security, make their lives better, and increase the safety of everyone involved. Yet, he hesitated. Very frustrated. I finally got him to reveal the problem. He said, "If everything in your proposal goes perfect, I get nothing. But if anything goes wrong, and my name is on this, I will get a black mark in my file that will remain there until I retire." That could either end my career or affect my career. So if you've ever worked in the business world with bureaucrats and try and get them to make a decision, very, very difficult thing because many people do not want to make a decision where they could be wrong. No one wants to make a wrong decision. Don't get me wrong here. But many people avoid making good decisions because they're so afraid of the wrong one. I learned a long time ago that getting a person to make a decision could be the difference between success and failure. In spiritual things, getting a person to make a decision for Christ will affect them throughout eternity. When in sales, I had a motto that was, timid salesmen have skinny kids. Now, I don't want my kids to be chubby, but I wanted them to be healthy. Most of us have sat through a timeshare. And a timeshare salesperson who can close one extra sale a week, one extra sale a week, can take their income from just being average to being in the top 5% of the entire country. One sale a week. Now in sports, there are different five kind of people or finishers, if you please. Let's say five kinds of finishes for people. There are disqualified runners. In sports, it's like a sprinter who jumps the gun or like a false start in football. You've got to bring everything back. You've got to start over. You have people that finish out of the running. They went downhill in the last part of life and embarrassed themselves like a player who signed up for millions but never lives up to their billing. Then you have a so-so player. They weren't among the leaders, they weren't among the losers, they finished in the middle, and they're kind of average. Then you have those that are suspended for breaking the rules. I read once the New York Knicks were eliminated from the NBA championship because their stars were suspended for clearing the bench in a fight. For those that follow baseball, Pete Rose, betting on baseball, suspended. And then there were those that finished well. They're not always the winner, they're not always the MVP, but they play the game well, they play at or above their ability consistently, and they personify sportsmanship in the game they play. But every sports figure knows that there's somebody younger, somebody faster, someone quicker that may come up through the ranks and displace them. By the way, Joe Flacco jerseys are 70 to 80% off in the clearance bin this week. He's a great quarterback, but they found someone that they liked a little bit more. Good, bad, or indifferent, that's the way life is. So we talked about five kinds of finishes for sports figures, but there are different kind of finishes for people in the Bible too. And we're going to focus this morning on those who finished well. Dr. J. Robert Clinton, professor at Fuller Seminary, did a study of male leadership in the scripture and determined that only 30% of them finished well. Of the other 70%, some of the things we talked about, some are like, okay. And some of them disqualified themselves. Different things, only 30% finished well. Now, if I were to ask for a show of hands, how many want to finish well in your life? I think all of our hands would go up. Yeah, I want to finish well. I want people to think well of me. I want my family and friends not to be happy I'm gone, but to miss me at least a little bit. But I want to finish well. But will we commit ourselves to finishing well? To define it, to finish well means to walk with God personally through the end of your life. To make a contribution to God's work with your time, your talent, and your treasure. Of those three, your time and your talent are more important than your treasure. God does not need your money. God does not need my money. He needs for us to not be so selfish, but He needs our time. He needs our talent. And then the third thing would be to leave a heritage and children who will continue the work of God. just a few Bible examples. Job. We remember Job went under every kind of personal suffering possible. After his children were gone, after his wealth was gone, after his position in the community was gone, his friends sat around and said it was his own fault. Job's wife turned to him and said, "Curse God and die." And he told her, probably at the lowest point of his life, "Thou speakest as one of the foolish women speaketh. What? Shall we receive good at the hand of God, and shall we not receive evil?" In all of this, Job did not sin with his lips. Job 2:9. We are not given an account of Job sinning. Now, Job was a sinner. We know he was a sinner, but it was not written in the scripture. Even though his friends accused him, they accused him wrongfully. Job did not sin with his lips. We read about Joshua. Joshua conquered the promised land for Israel when Moses had fallen by the wayside. And the very last of his life, he challenged everyone, all the children of Israel, to live for God and testified at the very last, "But as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord." We need more mamas and daddies that say, "I don't care what this world does. We will serve the Lord in our house." It is often said of Joshua, or it's said of him, "There came to pass after these things that Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died, being 110 years old, and they buried him in the border of it, in his inheritance in Timnath-Serah, which is in Mount Ephraim. And Israel served the Lord all the days of Joshua and all the days of the elders that outlived Joshua." Joshua and those people that he had taken time to mentor, they all served the Lord. A very rich legacy. We have Caleb. When the 12 spies returned from going to Jericho and looking at the land, 10 brought back a wrong report, a report of unbelief, but not Caleb. He and Joshua believed that they could conquer the land with the Lord's help. The 80-year-old Caleb said, "Behold, the Lord hath kept me alive, as he has said, these 45 years, even since the Lord spake this word to Moses. As yet I am strong in this day as I was in the day that Moses sent me. As my strength was then, so is my strength now, for war to go out, to come in. Now therefore give me this mountain where the Lord spake in that day. If so, the Lord will be with me, then I will be able to drive them out as the Lord has said." Daniel, we remember Daniel. As a young man, he was tempted to eat from the king's table. In fact, he was commanded to eat from the king's table. But he stood true to God. He says, "No, no, no. This does not work for me." And he worked out a deal. He did not bow down to foreign gods, but bowed down to Jehovah and was thrown in the lion's den for it. He knew what the outcome of that situation would be, but he did the right thing anyways. Daniel is another one of the very few people in the scripture that there was never written or recorded a sin that he committed. Again, there was only one perfect person, but Daniel lived such an upright and righteous life that there was no sin in his life worth mentioning in scripture. And then we come to Paul the Apostle. We're going to settle here for a few minutes. We all know of his life story with his trials, his physical sufferings, the strong discipline that he had, the character that he had. In Philippians chapter 3, Paul said, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of his sufferings, being made conformable unto his death, not as though I had already attained or already were perfect, but I follow after that I may apprehend that for which I am also apprehended of Christ Jesus. Brethren, I count not myself to have apprehended, but this one thing I do, forgetting those things are which behind, forgetting those things which are behind, reaching forth to those things which are before, I press toward the mark for the prize of the high calling of Christ Jesus. The sermon clip this morning struck me. You know, there are a lot of critics out there in our day and age more than ever, because people are able to hide behind the veil of Twitter and different things like that with false names, and they control other people who are trying to do good things. And the runner this morning said, they talk about it, I run, I do it. If you're out there running the race, if you're out there living for the Lord, if you're doing the right thing, there are going to be people that are critical of you. Oh my, so what? Do the right thing. At the end of Paul's life, and our scripture this morning, I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, I have kept the faith. Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me at that day, and not to me only, but all to all them who love his appearing. Paul's ministry lasted about a little over 30 years. From the Damascus event, on the road to Damascus, to the time when he was killed in prison. And the first point I want to make on your list there, taken right out of verse 7. I have fought an excellent fight. Now, the year is about 65 A.D. when he's writing this. Emperor Nero has taken the throne. Nero despises Christians and persecutes them with severity and brutality. Paul's a casualty of this persecution, and he's in prison awaiting his death. It is in that situation, he says, I am already being poured out like a drink offering, and the time has come for my departure. Now, that's a few verses before our text. To see what this is all about, we have to go back to the Old Testament. The drink offering accompanied nearly every temple sacrifice that was made. The morning and evening temple sacrifice. The sacrifices were made at all three Israelite feasts. It also accompanied all personal sacrifices. The drink offering was the last step in the sacrificial process. The whole fermented drink was poured out in the holy place. Nothing was held back from God. Whenever this was done, the result was a pleasing aroma to the Lord. Paul said, I am a drink offering. I am pouring out my entire life. I am holding nothing back. I am always before God. I have been set apart for service for God. My purpose is to please God. That is my calling. That's the way Paul the Apostle felt. Knowing your calling is very important because it gives you purpose and it enables you to know that you are contributing to the overall goal. Our goal as Christians is kingdom building. Kingdom building, the larger kingdom of Christ, which will, when the Lord comes back, he will set up his kingdom on this earth for 1,000 years. Now, if you have any folks that are afraid of the earth being destroyed because we use styrofoam baskets for our takeout or we use plastic straws, let them know that the Lord himself, according to the scripture, will be setting up his kingdom on this earth. You are not going to be able to destroy the earth with your plastic cups and your plastic straws and your styrofoam containers. You don't have that power. Second thing, I have finished my full course. Now this is going to be important next week because I had a lot of starters and not so many finishers. Brings us back to Paul and his circumstances. When Paul makes this declaration about the calling of God, he's in jail. He's been imprisoned for his faith. He is facing the death sentence. It was a small, dark, damp room with a tiny opening in the wall for light. He had to rely on his friends to look after him because the jailers didn't care. Remember when he wrote to Timothy, bring me the parchments, bring me the gifts, and bring my coat? He would rarely leave the cell. It wasn't allowed. He was sentenced to death. Again, we mentioned before, he's been serving God for over 30 years, and here's what it comes down to. Sitting in a dark, dank, cold, rat-infested hole as a prisoner. It's time for his departure. The Greek word departure being used there is the word they use when they are talking about untying a boat from its moorings that it has sailed. Similar word to taking the yoke off an oxen at the end of the day to relieve them of their burden for the night. This is not a departure in the sense that the end is over, but a departure in the sense that a new journey is about to begin. Paul is coming to the end of his earthly adventure of 30 years for Jesus, but he is going to another, a heavenly adventure, an eternity with Jesus. And he says it's all been worth it. When you see Paul act this way, we can't help but be confronted with a very important question. Do we, as individuals, have enough trust in God's plan to finish well, even when we find ourselves in difficult circumstances and in circumstances that are testing our faith? Do we have enough to finish well? Final thought. Verse 7, the latter part, I have kept my heart full of faith. Not always easy to have that attitude. We all know people who came, made a profession of faith, but they've lost their faith somewhere along the way. They don't attend church anymore. They don't serve the Lord anymore. They don't live for God anymore. There are times when we catch ourselves thinking, I have had enough of this mess. Perhaps it was a while ago, a month ago, a week ago, or yesterday. Maybe you have that feeling right now. I've had enough. I can't take it anymore. I just want to give up. People struggle financially. People struggle emotionally. We struggle physically. We struggle spiritually. The world is turning upside down all around us. The things that we hold precious, the things we hold dear, are being thrown back at us with scorn. See, just because we say we belong to the family of God doesn't mean that everything in our life is going to go smooth. There are some days when we feel we've given our best, and our best just doesn't cut it. We find ourselves going through times when all we can do is count the sacrifices that we have made for the sake of the Lord, and the blessings are just out of reach. Being a disciple can be hard. When we seek to fulfill our calling, life does get hard. We need to stop and recognize we have a Savior who endured all of that and more for us. It's easy to picture Jesus in heaven before he came to earth, willing to be the sacrifice, willing to do all that was necessary to bring mankind back to God. Nobody else could have done it. We can picture our Lord at his birth, barely noticed, not of interest to the local religious leaders, hunted by a crazed politician by the name of Herod. We can picture Christ in his ministry, maligned, misunderstood, made fun of, mocked. Scripture tells us there were several times that they took up stones to kill him, but it was not yet his time. He was taken for granted by many. We can picture Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, almost overwhelmed by what he knew was just ahead of him. God's wrath in all of its horrors. We can picture him on the road to Golgotha, whipped, beaten, punched, kicked, mocked, blood dripping from a thorny crown pressed deep into his head. Every step and effort as he's spurred on by mocking faces. Laughter as he falls under the weight and the cross comes crashing down on him. We can picture that easily. We've seen many pictures. We've seen movies about it. But could you picture this? After Jesus stumbled for the 10th time, crowds spitting on him, laughing at him, mocking him. But this time he stands up and says, okay, that's it. No more. I'm not going to take it anymore. I will not put up with this. Why should I endure what's not mine to pay? It's not my sin. It's your sin. You deal with the consequences. I came to give life. You just sought to suck it all out of me. Well, no more. I'm not going to do this. Why should I? You are the ones who made yourself God's enemy and who abused the greatest gift from God. Jesus would have never done that. But the possibility was always there. At any stage in his ministry, he had the capacity to abort the mission and go down a different path. Remember his words to Peter at his arrest? Peter had just cut off the ear of the servant. And Jesus said, don't do that. Put that away. Do you think that I cannot call on my Father and he will at once put at my disposal more than 12 legions of angels? A legion is 1,000. He could have called 12,000 angels to protect him. On that very same night earlier, he had prayed, Father, if you are willing, please take this cup from me. In the midst of all of that suffering, and what he knew was still coming, what he had already endured and what he was about to endure, he could have said, enough is enough. It's just time to call the angels and get my Uber out of here. But he didn't. When we are tempted to give up this eternity is what we are to look toward. We need to look to the fact that Jesus has begun the work and now he has a job for us to do. He's relying on us to continue that work. We are his hands, we are his feet. We are his eyes, we are his ears. We are the only Jesus that some people will ever see in their lives. When we're tempted to give up, that's when we should look up. Look toward heaven. Look toward the fact that Jesus began the work. Perhaps your circumstances are dismal today. All of us have a top 5 list that we wish we could deal with. Maybe you're considering dropping out of the Christian race. From his dungeon, the Apostle Paul calls out, don't quit. Keep going. You can finish well. Paul says, keep in focus my view of the present. You can reproduce yourself in others to carry the torch after you. Those of us that have been blessed with kids and grandkids, can teach them in the ways of the Lord to carry on after us. View your life as a sacrifice to God. That's what Paul did. Your death will be a departure to be with Christ, like walking through a door into another room, into eternity. Keep in focus the view of the present. Keep in focus the view of the past. One day, everything in your life will be past. You'll be able to look back and say that you engaged in the struggle for the cause of Christ. You didn't drop out, you ran. You guarded the truth of the gospel. And then keep in focus the future. One day we will all stand before God as individuals. You and I will stand before God, the righteous judge. Live in view of that day. If you live with Paul's focus on the past, the present, and the future, you can finish well. There's an 800-kilometer trail that winds through the mountains of Washington, California. 497 miles. I had to look it up. Those who go on this hike face all sorts of obstacles, including lack of food and water, danger from wild animals, days of rain, mud, incredible physical exhaustion, loneliness, blisters, mosquitoes, and the extremes of heat and cold. Similar to the Adirondack Trail, but the Adirondack Trail is 2,200 miles. I think Pastor Duke has completed 46 stations on the Adirondack Trail. I don't know how many are out there, but yeah, one of his bucket list things is to complete all of them. But there was a study done on this this trail in California, and it was discovered that 90% of those who planned to walk the trail didn't make it. 50% never got started. Oh, that's too tough. I'm not going to do that. I'd be in that group. 40% quit after they started. Only 10% ever finished that long distance hike. Further study was made to determine the 10% success that succeeded, and it was discovered that all of them, when you boil it down, they made two important decisions. First, they decided that they would finish that trail. They would finish. No matter what happened, they would finish. That was number one. Number two, they expected bad things to happen to them. Wow, think about that. What did Jesus say to his disciples? In this world you will have trouble. They expected bad things to happen, and they decided that they would not be surprised or dismayed when it did happen, because they knew it was inevitable. They finished well because they started well. They finished well because they were determined to run well. They finished well because they failed well. That is, they knew there would be obstacles, and they knew they would get through. Running the race and finishing well can happen. Which means we want these verses to be the epitaph of our life, perhaps put on our gravestone. I have fought the good fight. I finished what I planned. I kept the faith by making good decisions. Just a couple of questions here for you to ponder. If you're planning to finish well, I don't know that anyone would admit to planning to fail, but that means we have to leave a legacy behind us. With whom are you currently trying to reproduce yourself, to pass on your faith, to pass on your goals and ambitions? As the Mission Moment clip says, who is your one? I hope you have somebody in your life that you're working with. If not, if the answer is no one, I'm not working with anyone, trying to reproduce myself, then ask God to give you someone. Lord, send me someone that I can mentor. Send me someone that I can help. Send me someone that I can encourage. Let me tell you something. It's not hard to find someone to encourage. You go out any place, and there are people in need encouraging. You probably run into a dozen people a day if you're out and about that don't know how they're going to go on one more day. You could be an encouragement to them. And then does the idea of departing to be with Christ, passing on, does that cause you fear or does it cause you peace? If it causes you fear, how can you change this? Realize that death is just stepping from this life of flesh and bone into the next life of spiritual bliss. When do you feel most like dropping out of the race? What encourages you to keep going at those times? Go back to those times. Today, though, there are those that we know finished well. We know those people in our lives. We know people who have fallen short. Next week we'll talk a little bit more about that and strategies to finish well. Believe it or not, Easter is 8 weeks from today. Who is your one? If you don't have your one, ask God to give you one. A person to pray for. A person to encourage. A person to mentor. A person to disciple. Let's all stand together and have a word of prayer. Yes, you can ask God for your one right there in your seat. But if you feel the need to come down, the altar is open. Lord, we're thankful for the examples of Scripture. Not only the good examples that we can try and achieve, but also the poor examples, Lord, that we can learn from their mistakes and errors. We pray that you go with us this day. Help us to find that one that you want us to help. In your name we ask. Amen. Let's remain standing.
Dearly Father, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity to come and bring the tithes and offerings to your storehouse, Father. We thank you for the opportunity that we have to make this money that we may bring glory to your name. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Sing a song and
praise
God.
take us safely to our home. We pray that you help us to finish our race well. We ask these things in your name. Amen.